and praise the Lord. I'm Suffragan Bishop Gregory Wells, the founding pastor of the O'Fallon Apostolic Assembly here in O'Fallon, Illinois. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the Spirit of Elijah Ministries presented by O'Fallon Apostolic Assembly. This broadcast gives us a wonderful opportunity to share with you the richness of God's great word. The Bible tells us that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Won't you take a few moments now and join us as we come together to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness, worshiping Him in spirit and in truth. God bless you as we enjoy the presence of the Lord.
There is none. name of Jesus. We give God great glory for the opportunity to come before the people of God once again. We're sending out prayers on behalf of the Scott family on today, the Lively Stone Fellowship of Churches, as they celebrate the homegoing of Mother Phyllis Scott. We also want to pray for Elder Gary Hill and his family on today, as we were made aware of a tragic situation involving a young child, 3 years old, lost his life. Man, we solicit your prayers on behalf of that family. We give honor to our bishop, Bishop Gregory Wells, Sr., in his absence, and to Mother Joyce Wells in her absence. Amen. We're thanking God for my lovely bride being here with us on this morning. Amen. Sister Veronica. Amen. And also accompanied by my baby boy, Joshua, better known as JC to me. Amen. And also to announce the new addition to our family. Amen. My daughter, Selena, gave birth to a healthy baby girl sometime this morning, 7 pounds, 1 ounce, goes by the name of Ella May. Amen. Baby number 3, daughter number 3. Amen. God bless you if you're watching, baby girl. Congratulations to you and Danny. Amen. In Jesus' name. Certainly, we give honor to each of you today in your respectful places. For those of you that are watching electronically, man, on Facebook or YouTube, we send greetings to you as well, and we solicit your prayers. Amen. As the Lord endeavors to speak to us on this morning, amen. I solicit your prayers in Jesus' name. We would like to invite your attention to the word of the Lord, found in the book of Psalms, chapter 124, verses 1 through 8. Psalms 124, verses 1 through 8. And it reads, King James Version, "If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, now may Israel say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side when men rose up against us, then they had swallowed us up quick when their wrath was kindled against us. Then the waters had overwhelmed us, the stream had gone over our soul. Then the proud waters had gone over our soul. Blessed be the Lord who hath not given us as a prey to their teeth. Our soul is escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken and we are escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and the earth." But all God's people say, amen. I ask that you would raise your Bibles before the Lord and say, "Lord, bless us through your word in Jesus' name." Amen, amen. God bless you on today. Amen. For our lesson on today, just want to talk about something here. Just go along with me and you'll catch up at some point. The central point, a pin or a shaft on which a mechanism turns or oscillates, is the definition of the word pivot. And it's with that in mind that I would like to use for a subject in your hearing. The pivotal point. Amen. The pivotal point. Most of us can relate to the moments in our lives when something occurred and we said, whew. Or maybe as an observer of somebody else's situation, and we say, oh my. We're reflecting or we're considering how the situation could have turned out much worse. So we say, whew. Or we may be empathizing with others and their predicament, and we say, oh my. And we've been witnessing how the dynamics of life can seemingly catch us unawares, totally changing the landscapes of our lives in a mere moment. Amen. It has been 20 years now since I called it the boy who cried wolf, better known as the Y2K disaster that never was. And if we compare that to a pandemic or illnesses and deaths, quarantines and stay-at-home orders, no basketball, no baseball, a failing economy, governmental turmoil, murder by police, riots, peaceful protesters having their constitutional rights violated from the highest level of the government, the reopenings and corona cases spiking. Many have stated that it's like they'd like to start 2020 all over again. Here we thought Y2K was gonna be something. Y2K was nothing. We didn't compare it to what's going on right now. The new normal now has citizens searching for creative coping skills, Lord have mercy, and techniques in an attempt to maintain their sanity. Divorces, I hear, are increasing from spouses just getting on each other's nerves because they're spending all day and night with them. We need to pray for those that are suffering from depression, as apparently this whole isolation thing, it intensifies their struggles. Can you say amen, somebody? Amen. And so King David, according to the scriptures, even having the distinction as declared by God himself, a man after God's heart, yet still he was a full partaker of the human experience, being handpicked by God and yet being overlooked by those who knew him so well, having a tremendous reputation, and he was highly popular in the community, yet he was hated with a passion by the one he so faithfully served, succumbing to the lust of his eyes and committing adultery and having an innocent, faithful servant killed to cover his failure. That's enough, brothers and sisters, to make us say, oh my. And 7 years later, and not surprisingly, trouble rose up in his own house. Surely now, after 8 wives and 10 concubines, we would expect that there would have been even more recorded history of drama in King David's house. After 4 years of plotting and planning, almost like a virus, infecting the hearts of the men of Israel, David's own son Absalom rose up against him. Lord have mercy. We find in 2 Samuel 15 verses 13 through 14 that there came a messenger to David saying that the hearts of the men of Israel are after Absalom. In other words, he has influenced them to follow him. And David said unto all his servants that were with him at Jerusalem, arise and let us flee, for we shall not else escape from Absalom. Make speed, he says, to depart, lest he overtake us suddenly and bring evil upon us and smite the city with the edge of the sword. Can you say amen, somebody? We find in the book of Psalms, chapter number 3, verse 1, it says that this was a psalm of David when he fled from Absalom, his son. And David, he said, Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Many are they that rise up against me. Now, David, being the man of war that he was, certainly he was not afraid, but rather because of his love for his son, he would not fight against him, so he fled. Can you say amen, somebody? Perhaps this was David's own version of social distancing. So now, some commentaries suggest that this psalm was written after David's escape from Absalom, the psalm from our text on today. This psalm, it was a moment of reflection, if you will, for David. It was a Selah moment, as we see that term in the Psalms. Selah means to just pause and think about it. The overarching message of the victory that he's talking about in this particular text, it hinges, in other words, it pivots upon four words. We can tell the devil, I have four words for you. Those of you that know me well oftentimes hear me say, I got three words. But for today, we tell the devil, I got four words for you. And in the Hebrew, the original Hebrew, those four words are Jehovah on our side. Can you say amen, somebody? Now this was David's imagination, if you will, as he reflected, but not as if he were uncertain. Like, you know how sometimes we imagine certain things in our lives, like, what would I do if I had $1 million? What would I do if I got married? That's just imagination, that's not a reality. But rather for David, this was a moment of perspective and reality. There was no question, brothers and sisters, as to whether or not God was on their side. But as a matter of perspective, in other words, he was saying, think about it this way. Now, without this pivotal place, this is what would have happened, in other words. Verse 2 through 5, it says, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, when men rose up against us, then they had swallowed us up quick. When their wrath was kindled against us, then the waters had overwhelmed us, the stream had gone out over our soul, then the proud waters had gone over our soul. Lord have mercy. The Message translation says it like this: if God hadn't been for us, when everyone went against us, we would have been swallowed alive by their violent anger. We would have been swept away by the flood of rage, drowned in the torrent. We would have lost our lives in the wild, raging water. Can you say amen, somebody? Now, if we get the understanding of what David was trying to share with us, I'm reminded of what Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter number 5, verse number 17. He said, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Let me translate what he's saying here. He said, if any man pivots, he is a new creature. His perspective changes. His understanding changes. His vision changes when he pivots on the reality of God being on his side. Can you say amen, somebody? Pain and suffering, it used to cause stress and confusion. But after he pivots, he understands that God is not the author of confusion. His attitude is to think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which has come to try you, as though some strange thing has happened unto you. Lord have mercy, Jesus. I'm reminded of Asaph from the book of Psalms, chapter number 73. Asaph, he had a moment of lapse, but he remembered to pivot. Can you say
Amen, somebody. See, he said, truly God is good to Israel, even to such as of our clean heart. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped. Lord have mercy, Jesus. He said, for I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. Then he pivoted. Lord have mercy. Around verse number 16, when I thought to know this, it was too painful for me, he says, until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then understood I therein. Surely thou did set them in slippery places. Thou casted them down into destruction. Can you say amen, somebody? He stopped being envious when he pivoted on the reality that God was on his side. Lord have mercy. See, when we're troubled on every side, what we need to do is pivot. When we are perplexed, we need to pivot. Lord have mercy. When we are persecuted, we need to pivot. When we are cast down, we need to pivot. David said in verse number 1, after the pivot, he said, let Israel say. In other words, he said, let them say something. Let Israel testify. Israel in this text is the church. Can you say amen, somebody? Lord have mercy, Jesus. And then they do that thing in verses 6 through 8. Lord have mercy, they then began to testify. They said, blessed be the Lord who hath not given us as a prey to their teeth. Our soul is escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken and we are escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Lord have mercy. Come on, Israel. Testify after Pharaoh. Testify after the Red Sea. Testify after the Jordan River. Testify after the fiery furnace. Come on here, church. It's time to testify. Testify after the accident. Testify after the foreclosure. Testify after the surgery. Testify after the cardiac arrest. Testify after the cancer. Testify after the lies that they told on you. Testify, this is a good one. Testify after November 3rd, somebody. Lord have mercy, Jesus. Come on, church. After you pivot, don't forget to testify. Come on, pivot, y'all, and stick out your chest. Lord have mercy, Jesus. Not with pride, but with confidence. Lord have mercy. We can testify like Paul did in Romans chapter number 8. He said, what shall we say to these things? Can you see him with his chest stuck out now? Lord have mercy. After he pivoted, he came to their understanding that if God be for us, and that if is not a question about whether or not God is, it's really like him saying, since God is for us, can you say amen, somebody? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect with his chest stuck out? Come on, here, somebody. He said, it is God that justifieth. He said, who is he that condemneth? In Christ that died, yet rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? With his chest stuck out, he said, shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword. Lord have mercy, Jesus. As it is written, for thy sake we'll kill all the day long. My God's from Zion. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. He says with his chest somehow, nay, in all these things, we're more than conquerors. Through him that loved us, I am persuaded. See, after he pivoted, his mind got straight. He said, now I'm persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, or any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. My God from Zion.
I know you enjoyed that service just as much as I did. I'm sure that you could feel the very power of God's presence even at home while you were worshiping along with us. The Lord speaks to our hearts in such a way as to help us to go about our daily business. We are asking God to keep this word with us fresh so that we will never transgress His will. Let's take a moment now and ask God's blessing before we go our parting ways. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for what you've said to us today. We honor you for the richness of your word. We ask that you bless us, oh God, to be the people that you're calling for at the moment of your return. And we'll give you the glory, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. We would like each of you to visit us on the World Wide Web at www.ofallonapostolic.org. And until the next time we get together to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness, whether we meet you on the earth or meet you in the skies, we are looking forward to that time of great reunion, for that's our prayer and our blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.